and misunderstanding. People tend to have different perception, means that the way the people view things, visualize the things, understand the things, each and every person has a different way of understanding, due to which it is very important for us to communicate effectively with each other. In short, we can say communication is said to be effective when the sender and the receiver in the communication listen carefully to what all have been said. That is, it's very important part of communication that whatever the speaker wants to say, the same thing is transmitted to the receiver. Otherwise, confusion will be created and miscommunication can happen. Third, make the sender feel heard and understood. It is the responsibility of the receiver to motivate or to, through some body gestures or through various signs, he should show to the sender that he is being listened, which will help in motivating the sender and will help in effective communication because of miscommunication. The problem is, this problem has arisen due to poor communication. Whatever the sender wanted to communicate has not reached in exactly the same way to the receiver, due to which this argument or confusion has started. Moving on to the next slide. In the next slide also, you can see what is happening. This lady is the person who belongs to a company and he wants to hire an employee. And what is she saying? She is saying that your computer skills are lacking. That is, this person is not having computer skills. On the other hand, it would be great to hire someone who can't make a PowerPoint. And again, they want an employee who is good in computer skill. But on the other hand, they are saying that they want to hire a person who can't make a PowerPoint presentation only. Two things are contrary with each other, and hence the problem arises, and this is all because of miscommunication. Hence, it is very important for us to communicate effectively with each other. So we can conclude, if you just communicate, you can get by. That is, if we just want, we are communicating with each other, what will happen? The things will happen, no doubt about it. But if you communicate skillfully, you can work miracles. But if we communicate effectively and skillfully with others, then things which were impossible in the beginning seems to be possible. Miracles can happen, magic can happen, and things will run and go on very smoothly. So effective communication is very important for us. Moving on to the next slide, let's discuss about the characteristics of effective communication. We have already seen in our previous slide that why effective communication is important. Now let's see that why communication, what are the various characteristics which leads to effective communication. The first one is clear message, means that whatever the message the person wants to communicate, it should be communicated clearly to the receiver. So that is, clarity should be there. The way the receiver should get, or the way the receiver should understand that message, in that same way only the sender should be sending it. He should give clearly that message so that the receiver understand it clearly. Next characteristics is correct message. Means, if the message is not communicated correctly, then again problems would arise and it will lead to poor communication. The third is complete message. Complete message is already has been explained, that So attendance link will be given at the end. There will be only one form where you will be getting the feedback along with the assessment. I just request all the participants to wait at 4:30. The meeting, the training would be over. Before that, you will be getting that assessment and the feedback link. Then complete message. Complete message, earlier in our previous slide also, we have talked about incomplete information, half-baked information. So again, we are stressing on this thing that if the message is incomplete, then the purpose of this communication will not happen. It is very important for us to communicate the complete message to the other person. Fourth is precise message. Precise means that if we try to communicate extra information to the person, what will happen? The person may get confused. And if we try to pass on less information to the person, then what will happen? That the person will never be able to understand what we are trying to tell to him. Hence, the message should be reliable. Otherwise, we would also be losing the trust of the other person. Next, consideration of the recipient. That is, when the speaker is speaking something for the receiver, he should keep the things in mind about this receiver, who that person is, what kind of background he belongs to. In this way, the speaker will keep the receiver in mind, and will, in that way only he will be communicating with that person. What will happen? That the receiver will get the exact information, and again the sender will be clearly understood by the receiver. The last characteristics, sender's courtesy. That is, as it is the responsibility of the speaker, it is also the responsibility of the speaker to show empathy towards the sender. When the sender is speaking something, it is very important for the receiver to show gestures towards the speaker so that the speaker understands that he is being heard by the other person. The person, the receiver, should empathize with the sender, which is very important. Earlier only we have seen in a previous slide that it is a two-way process. Hence, speaker and receiver both should communicate, or both should have empathy for each other. Whatever we'll be talking about, the flow of communication, how this communication flow in an organization or wherever we are communicating. This communication starts with the sender. The sender is the one who wants to communicate with the receiver. So communication starts with the sender. This sender has some ideas, some views, some information which he want to pass on to the receiver. So he gathers all his ideas, encode them, transmits, or he frames them out for the receiver in such a way that he, the receiver, is understanding whatever he wants to communicate. After that, it is the duty of the sender to choose the proper channel. Proper channel means the medium of communication. There are various medium of communication. It can be written, it can be oral, it can be verbal. Whatever communication medium is being used, the sender should keep the receiver in mind and should communicate to the receiver. Now, when the information is passed on to the receiver, what does he do? He decode it. Decode, that is, he tries to understand whatever is being said by the sender. If there is any doubt in the mind of the receiver, then what will he be doing is, he will be raising those questions and would be clarifying them from the sender. And finally, he will be sending a feedback to the sender. This feedback is very important from the viewpoint of communication. Right? Because it is this feedback only which tells us that what the sender wanted to communicate, has it reached to the receiver in that same way? Yani ki jo sender kehna chahte the, wohi cheez ki usi tarah receiver ne samjhi hai ya nahi? This is the feedback which tells that thing. So feedback is a very important point in this flow of communication. Now we'll be talking about types of communication. In a previous slide only, we were talking that the medium of communication should be chosen by the sender. So now we'll be talking about the types of communication. So communication can be of four types. The first picture is showing you verbal communication. Verbal communication means communication through words, language. That is, the person, whatever he has or whatever he wants to share, he is trying to share the same thing through words to the other person. The clarity of the word, the language that he has chosen is very important, because the same thing will be passed on to the receiver. So this is verbal communication. Next, we'll be moving on to the next communication, that is non-verbal communication. As it has already been reflected in this picture, that non-verbal communication means communication through gestures, by emotions, by showing feeling towards the other person. So whatever the feeling the person has, that communication, that thing can be expressed by use of gestures, by facial expressions, by body language. This form of communication is called non-verbal communication. Abha Sharma ma'am, the link will be sent at the end of the session. Kindly wait for the session to complete. The third communication is written communication. Written communication can happen in a form of a letter, mail, documentary, report, article, or etc. That is, there are many forms of written communication. This written communication is very important in business organization. Why? Because this communication, this written communication, helps in keeping a track of the evidence or keeping a record with the organization. So business organization generally prefers this written communication. The fourth one is visual communication. What is this visual communication? Visual communication includes communication through graphical representation, through slides, yes. Then it can be through graphs, it can be through animation, it can be through pie chart, bar chart. Any form of graphical representation can be included in visual communication. What is the importance or the benefit of visual communication? Visual communication helps in expressing the things effectively to the receiver. Okay, now we'll be starting this slide now. Over here, we are being shown in the first picture that the person is saying something to the other. I'll just read out for you. This was a productive 4-hour leadership meeting. So this person is saying that they have conducted an 4-hour leadership meeting. Further, he is saying, I would like one of you to type up your notes and send an email to the entire company. After conducting 4-hour meeting, this person is asking the other participant that now they should gather up, they should write down the notes, and they should present those notes to the entire company. What is their, what are they doing over here? They are just looking at each other. They are just puzzled. They are not able to understand what they should speak up. Seeing their facial expression, this person is saying, no one took notes. He's asking whether anyone has taken the notes or not. And the people are giving an excuse. What are the excuse? I didn't have a pen. Okay, no problem. Does anyone remember what we decided? Okay, accepting these excuses, this person is saying that, okay, doesn't matter. At least try to recall whatever has been said in that meeting. Now, what are they doing? One is saying, we agreed to increase something. The other one is saying, no, decrease something. So confusion is created. As they have not prepared the notes, they haven't paid any attention in the meeting. What is the result? That everyone is seeing something else. Finally, this person decided, never mind, let's try it again. On Thursday at 8 a.m., that is, this person is saying that, okay, doesn't matter, we'll conduct that meeting again on Thursday at 8 a.m. And finally, in the end, what happens when is the next leadership meeting? The secretary is asking when this meeting has been scheduled. As usual, the practice, this person is again making an excuse and is realizing that he has forgotten everything. And he's saying, I should have written that down. He's realizing that he should have taken down the notes. So what we come up to? We come up to the barriers of communication. There are many barriers of communication which should be tackled down so that communication flows easily. Let's discuss the barriers of communication. The first one is physical environmental barrier. These physical environmental barriers are a result of time. That is, the time is not suitable to any of the person, whether it's the sender or the receiver. The place is not suitable or is not likable by the person, and hence they are not able to pay attention. Space, that is, the distance between the person matters. That is, at what distance they are speaking, maybe they are not audible or something like that. So space does matter. Climatic condition, maybe the person is, because of the weather, the person is feeling sleepy. Because of that, he is not able to sleep, he is not able to pay attention. Other can be the noise. The various other kinds of noise that are being heard by the person, they can also distract the person. So these comes under environmental barriers. Next kind of barrier is barrier caused by choice of medium, wrong choice of medium. Means that the medium of communication should be appropriate, or it should be according to the receiver. If we are telling, like in the previous slide only, if the person would have used a presentation or graphical representation would have been used by him, maybe he would have been able to communicate effectively to the other participants. Maybe it may happen that the medium of communication was wrong. The third barrier is semantic barrier, which means that the language, the words, vocabulary, the pitch, the tone, the voice modulation does matter, pronunciation. So these kinds of barriers also leads to miscommunication. The fourth one, cultural barriers. Because of the diversity of culture, what will happen? The person will be not able to respect. If the person is not respecting the culture of the other person, then obviously communication will not flow easily. Hence, again, it will result in miscommunication. The next type of barrier is psychological barrier or the attitude barrier. Moods changes frequently. Attitude of a person does matter. What is the attitude of that person, whether he's taking the thing seriously or not. If he's taking seriously, obviously he will be able to understand everything. But if he is just lethargic, he'll not be paying any attention to the thing. Relationship does matter. If the person likes the other person, obviously whatever will be said by the person will be liked by him. The person is not liked, they have an enmity between them. What will happen? Wo achha bhi bolega, the person, other person will not be agreeing or will not focus on that person. So this is again a barrier of communication. The last one is barriers caused by varying perception of reality. That is, the people have a different viewpoint. Each and every person have a different viewpoint. Their understanding level is different. How they understand, how they comprehend, again, differs from person to person, which again leads to miscommunication or poor communication. So these are the different kinds of barriers which affects the communication process. Now let's talk about how we can overcome these barriers. Overcoming the barriers of effective communication. These are just few examples through ways through which we can overcome the barriers of effective communication. Connecting with the audience. It is very important that we should connect ourselves with the audience. If we are not able to connect with the audience, what will happen? That the audience will, their attention will distract and they will not be focusing on whatever is being said. Is my voice audible to everyone? Yes. Okay then. Thank you. So connecting with the audience. So it's very important for us to communicate or to connect with the audience. Because when we communicate with the audience, what would happen? That we will stop them from distracting themselves. In this way, what will happen? They will be focusing and they will be paying attention to whatever has been said. Simple words. That is, if we use very difficult words which are not easily understood by the person, again, the person will not get to know the real meaning of our thing. Hence, it is very important that we should use simple words. Simple language should be used. Next, body language. In the previous slide also, we have talked about gestures, feelings, emotions, and body language. Just a smile on the face makes the person feels that he's being cared for. He is being listened to. So this does matter. Eye contact. When the speaker is speaking and the listener is having a direct eye contact with that person, it makes the speaker realize that he is being heard and he will be motivated and he will try to give his best to that person. Gestures, the tone, voice modulation, etc. All these things matter. Next, cultural sensitivity. Culture. We should respect the culture of the other person and we should not try to hamper their feelings. That is very important. We should be sensitive towards them, what they feel. And if this is done, effective communication will be there. Next, checking for understanding. Checking for understanding means that in between communication, what we should do is we should keep on checking whether what we want to communicate is being grasped by that person or not. So in between the communication, frequent checks should be done so that the person knows that what he wants to communicate is being received by that person in the same way or not. Seeking participation. Again, audience should be asked to participate in between. It can be done by asking a question. It can be done by telling them, yes, interaction. Interaction is very important for effective communication. Effective questions. When you are communicating with other person, obviously, if the person is listening to you, their curiosity will develop in him. Maybe there are some questions which you want to clarify, and that results in effective questions. The person will be having questions and he would like to discover them out. He would like to ask them out, and this leads to effective communication. Give views, yes, right. Summarizing what has been said. So the last one is that the communication should be summarized. That is, whatever the person wants to communicate, the listener should understand and summarizes down so that if any gap is there, he can fill that gap by asking or clarifying those doubts from the speaker. I hope the barriers, how we can overcome these barriers is clear to you all. Now we have talked about the barriers of communication, how we can overcome them. Now we'll be talking about the benefits of effective communication. Yes, it's right that communication should be effective, but why? What is the benefit that we will be achieving by effective communication? The benefits are quicker problem solving. Problem will be solved, or they wouldn't have arisen only because the person is just able to communicate properly and the receiver is getting exactly what the person is saying. Confusion in yoga, there will be no doubt, and automatically the problems would be sorted out. Better decision making. Since both the person will be on the same platform, what will happen? They will they will be able to create a mutual understanding, due to which decision making will be better. Steady workflow means that there will be no confusion, no arguments between the person, and hence the work will flow very smoothly. The work will not stop in between, and continuous flow of work would be seen. Strong business relations. This is very important in any organization, whether it is in school, whether it is in business. It is very important to establish strong business relationship, because when we establish strong business relationship, the person becomes trustworthy, loyalty established, and hence leads to a profitable, makes the organization a profitable one, increases the profit of that company. Yes, bonding is increased, better professional image. If we are able to communicate effectively, then we will be able to create a good image, a good professional image in the organization, which will be very effective for us. And finally, because of these benefits, or because of effective communication skill, the person will become a good leader, because he'll be able to understand the feelings of others, he'll be able to command others, he'll be able to express himself very nicely to the others, and will and the other employees will also listen to that person. So effective communication skill can help a person in becoming good leader. Next, now we will be talking about communication in students' life. How communication help in the overall development of a child? Why communication classes are essential in the school and societies? To build strong communication skills in student. Yes, it's very important for our students to develop or to build a strong communication skill. Because until and unless they will communicate, they will not be able to reach or achieve success. Second, to make them feel confident about themselves while talking in class or outside. Confidence can only be developed when the person is able to communicate. When the person is not able to communicate, what will happen? The person will feel very shy, will feel that if I'll make mistake, other will laugh at me. Due to this reason, what will happen? He will be secluding himself from others and will be just living a very lonely life. So confidence should be developed in the child, that he can communicate easily, and for these communication classes are essential. Next point, to make them understand things accurately, get the exact point of view of the teacher. Communication classes will help the students to understand whatever the teacher wants to communicate to him easily. as the teacher main purpose is to pass on information or to pass on knowledge to the student. That is why it is very important to have these communication classes. The attendance link will be sent at the end of the training. Kindly wait. Presentation in the class by a student. Yes, it's improved communication skill. Good communication skill is something that lasts till our death. And so it is essential for everyone. A single word wrongly said will be remembered by the person. And that is why it is very essential for us to communicate effectively. Next, to make them have greater career opportunities in the future, every work in a generation requires good communication skill. Be it any sector, everywhere communication skills are important. If the child lacks communication skill, then he will not be able to take admission or he will not be able to achieve success or fulfill his goal. That is why it is very important to develop communication skill in a child. To help the student achieve the specific goal that they have been born for. Every child is having a dream. Every child is having a specific aim in his life, a specific goal in his life. These communication skills help the child in achieving those goals, those aims. In fulfilling those aims. Now we'll be talking about the four communication skills which are very essential for the overall development of a child. First is thinking skill, second listening, third speaking, and fourth is non-verbal. Now we will be taking one by one and discussing these skills. The first is thinking skill. So it is very important for us to develop critical thinking in a child, because when we develop this critical thinking, what will happen? The child will be able to analyze the situation. Yani ki wo samajh payenge ki wo situation kyun hui hai, why this problem has arisen, and what they should be doing it. Reasoning. Then they will be able to reason out that what should be done and how, and what is the root cause of this problem. This is all because of their thinking. So critical thinking is very important. After reasoning out the problem, they will be coming up to an evaluation. They will evaluate a solution for it. They will come up to a decision where they will try to sort out that problem. So they will be evaluating that problem. And finally, they will be able to solve that problem. And at the end, they will be able to make a decision and will be able to clear out everything. The whole process, this every steps, all these steps are just because of the critical thinking skill only. If we are not able to develop this critical thinking skill in the child, then he will never be able to analyze the things. He'll not be able to reason out why such a thing is happening. And obviously, if he'll not be able to reason out, then he will not be able to come up to a solution. Hence, critical thinking skills are quite important. Next is active listening skill. We have already started that that listening skills are quite important. The receiver should be an active listener. So how we can develop those skills? Ask open-ended questions. What are open-ended questions? Open-ended questions are those questions whose answer cannot be given in yes and no. That is, an explanation is required in those questions. So obviously, when an explanation is required, then obviously the person will be listening to it. the thing, the question will be listened, and whatever the solution or whatever the explanation is being given, he will be able to listen it up. Active listening skill can be developed through it. Request clarification. When he will be paying attention and he will be focusing on the thing, what will happen? He will be having some doubts, he will be having some curiosities which he want to clarify, and he will be asking clarification of those things from the speaker. Be attentive. To become an active listener, it is very important to be attentive, to focus, to concentrate on whatever is being said. That is the most important thing for active listening. Summarize. In our previous slides also, we have this point. Summarize everything, whatever has been said. The person should be able to summarize it down, through which the person will be realizing that whether he has missed a point or not. Agar koi point miss hoga, to then the person can easily ask the speaker, and clarification can be done, doubts can be solved, and he'll be able to get to know the exact thing. Be attuned to the feelings. Be attuned to the feelings means that is, we are empathizing, we are just sensitive towards the feeling of the speaker also. We are showing our feelings and we are trying to understand the feelings of others also. Asking probing questions. Whatever the curiosity has been developed in the mind of the listener, it is very important to clear those doubts, to satisfy himself and ask those questions, and then only the person will be able to become an active listener. Yes, clearing doubts, right? Okay, then moving on to the next slide. Speaking skill. Now, we'll be discussing about the characteristics of a good speaker. The most important characteristic of a good speaker is to develop confidence. And confidence can only be developed when the person learns to speak effectively. So it is very important to develop confidence, and that can only be developed if the person is good in grammar, it's good in pronunciation, has a good vocabulary. Then only the person can develop confidence in him. Plenty of eye contact. That is, he should be establishing an eye contact with the listener. In this way, the listener will feel that he is being paid attention, he is giving an importance. And what will be the result of this? Result will be that the listener will also focus and concentrate and will pay attention to whatever is being said by the speaker. Good body language. Just standing stiff over there and speaking whatever you want to say will not help you out. Movement of the hand, gestures, smile, nodding of the head, the movement, everything matters, which help us in becoming a good speaker. Speaking, not reading, means it may happen that a person has written a speech on a piece of a paper, and when he's presenting that speech in front of the audience, he's just looking at the paper and reading it out. What will happen? The listeners will not be paying attention to that person. They'll not be focusing. Neither the speaker will be able to look at the reaction of the listeners. Hence, it is very important to use voice modulation, to use different tones, pitch of the language, the pitch have to be used. Then only the speaking can become an effective one. Commanding attention. Since the speaker is the one who is speaking, it is his duty to command attention, from the audience. If he will be forcing them to participate, he will be asking them to participate. What will happen? They will be paying attention and they will be interacting frequently with the speaker, speaking with authority. Over here, the speaker should have the whole soul control. The speaker is the one who should have the command in his hand. If he is having the command, then he will not let the listener divert his attention here and there. So, authority, he should establish a leadership quality in him. Then only he can become a good speaker. Attendance link will be shared at the end of the training. Kindly wait. It's 4:10. Few slides are left. Let me complete the presentation and after that I will be sharing the assessment form and the feedback form. The four speaking skills. These four speaking skills are quite important to become a good speaker. The person should be fluent in the language, should have a good vocabulary, should have good pronunciation, and should have a good command over the grammar. If all these four skills are achieved, then the person will naturally become a good speaker. So we have discussed the three kinds of communication skill. Now only the fourth one is left. We will be coming up to that. How to improve non-verbal communication skill? This is the same thing that we have discussed in our previous slides, that is maintaining an eye contact with the audience, nodding your head to convey that you agree, that whatever you are whatever you are hearing, you accept it and you agree with that. Just a nod of your head will make the speaker realize that you are with him. Smile and show interest. Again, smile will help the person know that you are showing interest in whatever he is saying. Lean forward to show speaker your interest. That is, just being stiff and just standing erect over there will make the person speaker realize that you are not interested in the communication. But when the body movement is shown, you are leaning forward, you are just paying attention, then the person will realize that you are with him and you are connected with that person. Use tone of voice that matches your message. Obviously, the tone of voice matters. If you are just saying something very politely, you have to say the thing very softly. If you are commanding the voice, the tone of your voice will be changed. It will be an authoritative tone then. So, order. So different modulations of voice should be used by the speaker so that the person, the receiver, understands the things easily. Voice modulation according to the situation. Yes, very right. That is, according to the situation, according to the requirement, voice modulation should be done. Now, we'll be discussing about few of the activities through which communication skill can be improved in children. I know that each and every educator that are here are using some or the other ways through which the communication skill can be improved. But few skills, few activities I would like to share with you through which we can increase or we can improve the communication skill in children. First is Dhamshra that we usually know and we are obviously the students are playing with it, but we can bring a change in it. We can make it emotional Shra. That is, we can give these words to the students and show them a picture or ask any of the student to have this facial expression. What will happen? That is, now they have to guess the correct word or they have to match the correct word with that facial expression. The result will be that the vocabulary will enhance and they will understand the various facial expression. It's a very good way of improving the communication skill in the small children. Next, Chinese whisper. This is frequently used everywhere. That is, the first person, whatever he wants to communicate, he passed on this message to the second one. The second one passed on to the third and to the fourth, and finally it comes to the final receiver. Through this, we are able to understand the communication skill, the listening and the speaking skill of these people. How? That is how effectively this person has told the thing to this person, how much he has listened to it and has passed on to the next person. So Chinese whisper can be used. The next one is speak, listen and draw. This activity I have also used in my class. What I have done is that I have given this picture to this one of the students and asked him to describe it out to the other without telling what he is asking them to draw. That is, instead of telling rectangle, he has to tell what he is trying to ask. So over here, the one of the student will be describing this out, others would be listening to it, and then they will be drawing it out. Finally, when the entire picture has been described, what will happen is that they will be showing what they have drawn, and then they can match it with the real picture and then come to know how effective listener they were. It's a very good exercise of checking the speaking and listening skill of students. Next one, dicebreaker. Over here, what we can do is that we can fix a particular activity for each of the number on the dice and ask the student to throw that dice. Whatever number comes according to that, the child is asked to perform the certain task or to do that activity. What would you do if? To make the person, the student, a critical thinker, we are providing a situation to that person. So we are playing a game through which we are forcing the child, we are telling the child to imagine himself in a certain situation and tell us what he will be doing if he is found in that particular situation. Like, if we start off from here, what will he do is that there were 30 hours in a day. So if the number of hours are increased, what the child will do? So obviously the child will develop critical thinking and then he will be speaking it out. Then critical thinking and then speaking skill. Both the skills can be developed through this activity. Just few slides are left, two or three slides are left, kindly wait. Next, description game. This game can be played in various ways. Over here, we can ask the child to describe any object, anything, and it may happen that the other person is guessing what that object is. It may happen that we are asking the student to describe his mother, his father, or his friend, or the place where he lives, the house where he lives, or the game that he likes. Due to this, what will happen? The listening skill will be developed, the speaking skill will be developed, and visualization of the child will improve. So we can use all these skills to develop, to improve the communication skill in our students. Next, guessing the right picture. What has to be done in this? We'll be requiring few books with pictures in it. The children will be sitting in a pair and a book will be given to each of the pair. The child will be selecting a picture from the book and he will be describing it to the partner. The partner will be paying attention, and after that he has to find out that picture which has been described by his partner. And after that the roles will be reversed. So again, listening skill, speaking skill can be improved by these activities. Next, storytelling. In storytelling also, what we can do is that we can show a picture to them, we can ask them to describe the story, or what we can do is that, again, what we can do is, we can ask one of the students to start the story. After the student say two or three lines, after that we can ask the student to sit and ask the second student to continue from that point only. What will happen with this? that the story which has been created by the first student will be converting and will be moving into a different direction by the other students. It's a very good exercise through which again the creativity of the child will be seen, the critical thinking will be seen, can be checked, listening, speaking. When someone, everybody knows that any time the person can be asked to continue with the story, obviously the person will be paying attention. He will be listening carefully. So listening skill is also developed, speaking skill, critical thinking, creativity can be seen. So all these activities can be used in the class to develop or improve communication skill in our students. Well, that's the end of my presentation. It's 4:20. I am just going to share the attendance and feedback link with you. And attendance link will not be shared separately. Only one link will be provided to you.
Okay, participants, please listen. There will be no attendance link shared for you because from now onwards, the WebEx will automatically record your presence for the session. How many minutes you have attended and how many times you have logged out or logged in, everything has been recorded in WebEx platform. So your attendance is marked in the WebEx and from there we will extract and we will provide you the e-certificate in the portal, CBSE portal. So I request all the participants that on Tuesday, next week on Tuesday.
In that link only.